वेलकम फ्रेंड्स, वेलकम टू द नॉलेज क्लब ऑनलाइन। नाउ आई एम गोइंग टू डिस्कस अबाउट द स्ट्रक्चर ऑफ डीएनए। डीएनए इज अ फंडामेंटल बायोकेमिकल फीचर दैट इनकोड्स द जेनेटिक इंस्ट्रक्शंस यूज्ड इन द डेवलपमेंट एंड फंक्शनिंग ऑफ ऑल नोन सेलुलर ऑर्गेनिजम्स। डीएनए इज यूज्ड फॉर द स्टोरेज ऑफ जेनेटिक इंफॉर्मेशन। At first, we discussed about some history about the DNA. DNA is a fundamental biochemical feature was first isolated by the Swiss physician Friedrich Messier in 1869. DNA's role in heredity was confirmed in 1952 by Alfred Hershey and Martha Chase. In 1953, James Watson and Francis Crick suggested what is now accepted as the first correct double helix model of DNA structure. Now I come to the four building blocks construct DNA structure. The structure of DNA helps to create a relationship between structure and function. DNA is a linear polymer made of three things: deoxyribose sugar, phosphate, nitrogenous bases. The phosphate and sugars are strung together to make a backbone. The backbone is on the outside of the molecule. Each sugar is connected to two phosphate groups through different linkages. Each sugar is oriented in the same way, and so each DNA strand is polar, with one end distinguishable from the other. Joined to each deoxyribose is one of four possible bases: adenine, cytosine, guanine, thymine. We know the adenine and guanine are the purine bases and cytosine and thymine the pyrimidine bases. Here we can see that each sugar joined with one base, and each sugar is linked with two phosphate groups. Here the four possible bases: adenine, cytosine, guanine, and thymine. Now I come to the nucleotides are the monomeric units of nucleic acids. A unit consisting of a base bonded to a deoxyribose sugar is referred to as a nucleoside. In each case, N9 of a purine or N1 of a pyrimidine is attached to C1 of the sugar. The base lies above the plane of sugar when the structure is written in the standard orientation, that is, the configuration of the N-glycosidic linkage is beta. Here we can see at the animation video, that is the beta glycosidic linkage. A nucleotide is a nucleoside joined to one or more phosphate groups by ester linkages. The most common site of attachment in naturally occurring nucleotides is the hydroxyl group attached to the C' of the sugar. A compound formed by the attachment of a phosphate group to a C5' of a nucleoside sugar is called a nucleoside 5-phosphate or a 5' nucleotide. Then I comes to a pair of nucleic acid chain, single strands with complementary sequences can form a double helical structure. In 1953, James Watson and Francis Crick deduced the arrangement of these strands and produced a three-dimensional structure for DNA molecules. This structure is a double helix compound of two intertwined strands arranged such that the sugar phosphate backbone lies on the outside and the bases on the inside. The bases form specific base pairs held together by hydrogen bonds. Example, adenine pairs with thymine and guanine pairs with cytosine. The features of the Watson-Crick model of DNA deduced from the diffraction patterns are: two helical polynucleotide chains are coiled around a common axis. The chains run in opposite directions. The sugar phosphate backbones are on the outside of the plane. And the purine-pyrimidine bases lie on the inside of the helix. The bases are nearly perpendicular to the helix axis and adjacent bases are separated by 3.4 angstrom. Here, this is the 3.4 Armstrong. And every strand is separated . The helical structure repeats every 34 angstrom, and so there are 10 bases, 34 angstrom per repeat per 3.4 angstrom per base per turn of helix. There is a rotation of 36 degrees per bases, 360 degrees per full turn per 10 bases per turn. The diameter of the helix is 20 angstrom. This total diameter of the helix is 20 angstrom. Now I come to the double helix is an expression of the rules of chemistry. First thing is electrostatic interactions in DNA. Each phosphate group in a DNA strand carries a negative charge. Thus, unfavorable electrostatic interactions take place when two strands of DNA come together because of negative charge in each phosphate group. The negative charge of phosphate groups in one strand repulses the second strand's phosphate group. These phosphate groups are far apart in the double helix with distances greater than 10 angstrom. Thus, electrostatic interactions oppose the formation of the double helix. The strength of these repulsive electrostatic interactions is diminished by the high dielectric constant of water and the presence of ionic species such as Na+ or Mg2+ ions in solution, These positively charged species interact with the phosphate groups and partly neutralize their negative charges. In this picture, we can see the phosphate groups. Negative charge of phosphate groups in one strand repulses the second strand's phosphate groups. This is the electrostatic interactions in the DNA. Now, the hydrogen bonds. In single-stranded DNA, the hydrogen bond donors and acceptors are exposed to solution and can form hydrogen bonds with water molecules. When two single strands come together, these hydrogen bonds with water are broken and new hydrogen bonds between the bases are formed. Because the number of hydrogen bonds broken is the same as the number formed. The base pairs are held together by specific hydrogen bonds, which although weak, 4 to 21 kJ per mole or 1 to 5 kcal per mole, stabilize the helix because of their large numbers in a DNA molecules. Next is the van der Waals contracts. Within a double helix, the base pairs are parallel and stacked nearly on top of one another. The typical separation between the planes of adjacent base pairs is 3.4 Armstrong, and the distances between the most closely approaching atoms are approximately 3.6 Armstrong. This separation distance corresponds nicely to the van der Waals contact distance. The energy associated with the single van der Waals interactions is quite small, typically from 2 to 4 kJ per mole or 0.5 to 1 kcal per mole. Bases tend to stack even in single-stranded DNA molecules. In the double helix, however, a large number of atoms are in van der Waals contact, and the net effect summed over these atom pairs is substantial. In addition, base stacking in DNA is favored by the conformations of the somewhat rigid 5-membered rings of the backbone sugars. Next is the hydrophobic effect. The hydrophobic effect also contributes to the favorability of base stacking. The hydrophobic bases cluster in the interior of the helix away from the surrounding water, whereas the more polar surfaces are exposed to water. At last, the heat release. When solutions containing DNA strands with complementary sequences are mixed, the strands react to form double helices. This process results in a loss of entropy from the system, indicating that the heat must be released to the surrounding to avoid violating the second law of thermodynamics. Now comes to the acid-base reactions can disrupt the double helix. The reaction between two strands of DNA to form a double helix takes place readily at pH 7. The solution containing the double helical DNA and treat it with a solution of concentrated base. With a high concentration of OH-, the pH rises. But the concentration of the double helical DNA does not change significantly. However, as the pH approaches 9, the DNA double helix begins to dissociate into its component single strands. As the pH continues to rise from 9 to 10, this dissociation becomes essentially complete. The hydroxide ions can react with bases in DNA base pairs to remove certain protons. The most susceptible proton is the one bound to the N1 nitrogen atom in a guanine base. Guanine, when it comes to the pKa 9.7, it releases the proton molecule. The DNA double helix is also destabilized by low pH 5. Some of the hydrogen bond acceptors that participate in a base pairing become protonated. In their protonated forms, these bases can no longer form hydrogen bonds and the double helix separates. Here we can see the guanine and the pKa level 2.48, it's getting the protonated. Thus, acid-base reactions that remove or donate protons at specific positions on the DNA bases can disrupt the double helix. Thank you. That's all for today.